The Supreme Court just started their fall term, and boy is it shaping up to be quite the demonetized session. Guns, gods, and abortions. It's a collection of hot topic debates designed to make this year's Thanksgiving as uncomfortable as societally possible. Today I decided to break down the top 9 debates going on at the Supreme Court, starting with number 9, the United States versus Zabayada. Can the United States hide evidence that it tortured people? In 2002, Zabayada, a known bin Laden associate, was picked up in Pakistan and transferred to a CIA black site in Poland. Unfortunately, a decade later, and things still aren't water under the board. Today, Poland is launching a criminal investigation into the CIA's behavior at that black site. And as you can imagine, Zabayada is very eager to give that court his scathing Yelp review. Problem is, he can talk to the Polish court all he wants, but without some documentary evidence, there is plenty of room for reasonable doubt. Zabayada filed an application to compel America to release documents related to his treatment in Poland, but unfortunately for him, there is one civil right that the CIA really, really cares about: their own right to privacy. The government is blocking the release of these documents, citing state secrecy. Gotta keep that whole torture thing on the hush hush. Now, America's information suppression argument stems from precedent set in the 1952 case of United States v. Reynolds. Now, in that earlier case, a plane crashed while testing out experimental equipment, killing several civilians. The wives of those civilians sued the government for damages. Then the drama kicked in. The Air Force refused to release accident reports and witness testimony that would have been vital to the case. Now, unfortunately, just take our word for it, doesn't really hold up in court. The Air Force's logic here was simple: we gotta protect the classified nature of the experiments we were conducting during that crash. In the end, it was held that the government may withhold information for reasons of national security even when that information is vital to the plaintiff's case. So, okay, things aren't looking great for today's Zabayada information request. Now, Zabayada's argument, on the other hand, relies on the fact that there is a gaping difference between the question of some secret military technology that was currently being tested at the time, and the question of whether the military tortured someone 18 years ago. The lower court decision on appeal today answered today's yes-no question with a resounding all of the above. They determined that some of the information sought in the Zabayada case, such as the identity of foreign nationals who work with the CIA, should not be disclosed because doing so risks damaging the intelligence relationship between the United States and Poland and could compromise current or future counterterrorism operations. But at the same time, the appeals court also recognized that, in order to be a state secret, a fact must first be, you know, a secret. They ruled that the CIA may need to turn over information, including the fact that the CIA operated a detention facility in Poland, information about the use of interrogation techniques and conditions of confinement in that Polish facility, and details about Abu Zabdaya's treatment there, which is already currently largely available to the public. Now, this "you at least have to tell the public what they already know" ruling was not good enough for the United States government, which led them to appeal that lower court decision to the Supreme Court today. Now, America's main point of contention with that lower court ruling is, despite being very generous about what information can be classified as state secrets, well, it puts the final power of determining what is and isn't a state secret up to the courts instead of the federal government. They get to go through the documents and say, well, you know what, this is important to state security and ongoing operations, but hold on here, well, this isn't, let's release it. The Department of Justice would prefer that that information goal line defense stay with the CIA instead. Here's what activities of ours you're allowed to know about: accountability. Now to case number 8, the United States versus Vaello-Madero. Can the United States deny benefits to US citizens living in Puerto Rico just because they live in Puerto Rico? So here's the skinny. Jose Luis Vaello-Madero is a United States citizen who lived in New York for 3 decades. During that time, he developed serious health problems and started receiving supplemental security income from the Social Security Administration. Everything's fine so far. In 2013, though, he moved to Puerto Rico and came into an awkward realization that, for the purposes of supplemental security income, people who live in Puerto Rico are considered outside of the United States. Just ignore maps, presidential votes, and representatives showing up to Congress. You're not part of the US for this purpose. Now, he's suing the United States because he's arguing that federal agencies discriminating against Puerto Rican citizens violates the Constitution's guarantee that no citizen shall be denied equal protection under the laws. Of course, there are two sides to every coin. America is relying on some fun old American laws passed a few century turns ago that dictate exactly how America is legally allowed to govern some of its territorial holdings. Now, as you can imagine, these laws do not fare well to people living in those territorial holdings. The last time these laws were interpreted was a near-identical Supreme Court case in the 1980s, Harris v. Rosario. Now back then, and stop me if any of this sounds familiar, America had a welfare program that paid more to United States residents than Puerto Rican residents, and somebody sued the United States citing the Equal Protections Clause of the Constitution. The 1980s Supreme Court held that, because Puerto Rico was an unincorporated territory, the lower levels of reimbursement provided to Puerto Rico did not violate the Fifth Amendment's Equal Protection Guarantee. Instead, Congress, pursuant to its authority under the Territory Clause of the Constitution, may treat Puerto Rico differently from states, as long as there is a rational basis for its actions. Now, that ruling might be check in today's legal chess match, but if it were checkmate, we would not be talking about it today. What that 1980s precedent established was, the federal government, in theory, can treat territories differently than the states, if there's a rational basis. So what's the rational basis for denying supplemental security income to Puerto Rico today? Well, Biden's Justice Department just filed a brief arguing that residents of Puerto Rico are generally exempt from most federal taxes, including the income tax, excise taxes, and estate and gift taxes. Congress could rationally conclude that a justification that makes a reduced contribution to the general federal treasury should receive a reduced share of the benefits funded by the general treasury. So, there you have it. Is a reduced federal tax a sufficient rational basis for withholding some federal aid to citizens, or are they protected under the Equal Protection Clause? We'll find out. So far, this list has been a bit on the depressing side, so let me hit you with a brief respite. Case 7, the Federal Election Commission versus Ted Cruz for Senate. That's right, this one has a famous person attached to it. Does regulating repayment of a candidate's personal loans to their campaign violate free speech? Now, campaign contributions are some of the most expensive free speech out there. This is one of those classic, probably should have settled it out of court situations. You see, Ted Cruz lent Ted Cruz for Senate quite a bit of money when he was running against Beto O'Rourke. Hey, someone had to fund the guy. Now here's the awkward part though. It's now after the election and Ted Cruz wants to get back some of that cheddar. Ted Cruz for Senate owes Ted Cruz the candidate quite a chunk of change. So what do you do? Well, Ted Cruz for Senate starts calling up donors to collect money and repay the debt it owes Ted Cruz. One problem, the law. At issue is a provision of federal election law that sets a $250,000 cap on the amount of post-election donation money that a campaign can use to repay a candidate's personal loan. Yeah, he pumped more than $250,000 into the Ted Cruz for Senate campaign and violated federal election laws when he tried to solicit donations to pay that fund back to himself. You can't do that with solicited post-campaign donations. Don't worry though, Ted. Still more than enough time to make it to Cancun. Ted Cruz argues that this election law violates his free speech rights because the government has failed to demonstrate that the loan repayment limit serves an interest in preventing quid pro quo corruption. Basically, okay, so I owe myself a bunch of money. I'm definitely not doing myself any favors with this one. Now, because it's my money being repaid to me, I should be able to lend my campaign unlimited funds and then after the election have my campaign solicit donations to pay the full amount back to me. This solicitation limit is arbitrary and does not reduce corruption. Now, the Federal Election Commission, on the other hand, counters by arguing that, whoa, there is a difference between the following two situations. Ted Cruz for Senate calling a corporate donor and saying, hey, we need $200,000 for a TV spot. And Ted Cruz for Senate calling a corporate donor to say, hey, we need $200,000 to put in Ted Cruz's personal bank account. To quote their filing, Cruz contends that a contribution used to repay a candidate's personal loan to his campaign operates in precisely the same manner as any other contribution. But that is not so. A contribution used to repay a personal loan made by the candidate directly increases the candidate's personal wealth, while a contribution used for campaign purposes does not. Now, they went on even further to pull at the string of another very interesting question. What even is free speech? Now, if your goal is to demonstrate support for a candidate or to give the candidate more money so they can buy campaign ads, well, all of that is null after the election has already concluded. You guys already spoke with the election funds. Now you're just paying the guy. Next to case number 6, Ramirez v. Collier. How do you extend religious liberty exemptions to death row inmates? Okay, so a Texas man, John Ramirez, is on death row. Texas is allowing a pastor to be in the room when John is executed, but will not allow the pastor to lay hands on the dying man or audibly pray. Whew, boy, the jokes just write themselves with this case. Can we go back to talking about Ted Cruz a little more? No? Okay. Well, the question here is, what is the state's interest in banning audible prayer and touching, and is there a less burdensome way of achieving that same goal? Now, the outcome of this case will very much be influenced by a similar 2019 case where the court ruled that it is acceptable for a prisoner-requested imam to be banned from entering an execution chamber during the execution of said prisoner. In that case, the court found that the state's compelling interest of maintaining security while a highly emotional and irreversible decision was being made could reasonably serve by banning third parties from being present. In today's case, on the other hand, the third party is already permitted to be present, he just has to awkwardly stand there. No touching or talking, just watch. Ramirez argued that forbidding the pastor from audibly praying or touching him substantially burdened his religious freedoms, and Texas could achieve their security interest through less intrusive means. Now, Texas, on the other hand, argues, no. The current interpretation of the law says we don't have to take requests from anyone, so we aren't gonna. Prisoner religious protection laws were written in a way that protects prisoners from being forced to do things that go against their sincerely held religious beliefs, but at the same time, they're very deferential to the state's systems when it comes to fulfilling religious requests. Basically, I can't force you to eat pork, but you can't make me go out of my way to find you a vegetarian option. Texas writes in their brief, that a state may not impose policies coercing an inmate to do what his religious tenets forbid does not mean that it must accede to his every religious demand. By design, prisons impede inmates' freedom to behave as they might wish, which necessarily limits some of their religious behavior. When an inmate seeks a special religious accommodation, as Ramirez does today, the court has not instructed as to when a prison's refusal to submit rises to the level of a substantial burden to religious exercise. So, where's the line? Well, we may soon find out. Who would have guessed that Texas would be on the government side of a Christian religious freedom case? Next, case number 5, CVS Pharmacy v. Doe. And as you probably guessed, this is not about to turn into an ad for CVS Pharmacy. Now this is a case about the American healthcare system, so buckle up! In America, you have groups called pharmaceutical benefits managers. Think of them as the middleman between insurers and pharma. I know a guy on the inside, you're gonna get a great deal if you work through me. Of course, I'm gonna take a small cut and control the distribution. Now, a bunch of healthcare plans work with these pharmaceutical benefit managers for purchasing and distributing medication. CVS is one of the largest pharmaceutical benefit managers. Now, here's where the hammer drops. CVS is also a pharmacy. Now this set the stage for a huge conflict of interest when CVS, the pharmaceutical benefits manager, announced that, if you need specialty medication and you buy that medication from your local pharmacy, well that's now out of network. Thousands more dollars a pill. Now you instead need to buy it from a CVS pharmacy for it to be in network. Now, this decision triggered 5 anonymous HIV-positive plaintiffs to file a disparate impact suit. Their argument is that they used to be able to buy all of their medications from one local pharmacy. Now they have to pick up some of their medications at the local pharmacy and their specialty medications at their local CVS pharmacy instead. That places a burdensome and entirely avoidable burden on people with conditions requiring specialty designated medications. Now, to be clear, the question isn't whether a pharmaceutical benefit manager can designate their pharmacy as the only in-network seller of specialty medications. Somehow that's all above board. Instead, the question is whether these PBMs can arbitrarily inconvenience people who require specialty designated medications over everybody else. Now I'm gonna yada yada over a super nuanced debate here, but SparkNotes version, there are two ways to conceptualize a discriminatory benefit design. Plaintiffs allege that any programs where the burden arbitrarily falls harder on individuals with special needs should be vulnerable to a disparate impact lawsuit. In this case, having to swing by CVS to pick up specialty medications when the same specialty medications are available at their local pharmacy where they pick up the rest of their medications, well, that has a disparate impact on people who need the specialty medications. Now CVS, on the other hand, well, they are taking a much broader view on disparate impacts. Alright, sure, people with special needs have to drive a bit further to get in-network specialty medicine, but is it really that much of a disparate impact? I mean, it's just a hint of inconvenience. Doesn't warrant a lawsuit. Now this debate is similar to a Supreme Court case from last year about voting laws in Arizona? Okay. Well, in that case, the courts ruled that, sure, Arizona voting laws had a disparate impact on disenfranchising minorities, but given the totality of circumstances, it's an acceptable disparate impact. They let that law stand. So we'll see what happens here. Now to case number 4, Carson v. Makin. Does it violate freedom of religion protections and equality clause protections for a state to ban students from tuition aid programs if they're going to be attending religious schools? Enter Maine, a state where more than half of school districts do not have a public secondary school option. To solve this, Maine whipped out the duct tape and scraped together a basic school system. Essentially, Maine provides robust tuition assistance for people who live in areas that only have private schools. Of course, having publicly funded private schools as a band-aid for no public schools introduces a huge potential problem. What if the private school is a religious private school? Maine refuses to provide tuition assistance to private religious schools, citing separation of church and state. Our private school subsidies will only go towards secular private schools. Now this case is kind of a sequel spin-off to a case from last year, Espinosa v. Montana Department of Revenue, in which a similar problem had emerged. In that 2020 case, the Supreme Court eventually held, a state need not subsidize private education, But once a state does choose to do so, it cannot disqualify some private schools solely because they are religious. So, okay, that kinda feels like checkmate against Maine in this case. Why are we relitigating things exactly a year later? Did the court need to pad its docket a little bit this term? Well, the big difference here is that last year's ruling bans disqualifying religious institutions from government programs based on their religious status. Maine's subsidy program, well, they don't actually do that. St. Mary's High School could still get a fat check from the federales. Maine's program instead bans participation based on religious use, meaning it doesn't fund schools whose curriculum explicitly include religious teachings. As long as your religious institution keeps religion out of the classroom, they won't be excluded from Maine's program. So is that enough to keep this from being a freedom of religion violation? I'm putting my money on that snowball in hell. But we'll see what the court comes up with. Next? Now to case number 3, and oh boy, this is where things really start heating up. Now this is a huge, meaty, and confusing blob of a case with grand implications. American Hospital Association v. Bercerra. When Congress gives federal agencies the power to set policy, how much leeway do those agencies enjoy? Now before we get to the real meat of this case, let me just pitch you on its significance. In general, when Congress passes sweeping pieces of legislation, parts of it tend to be a little bit vague. To give you a recent example, we all remember the eviction moratorium debate, right? Well, decades ago, Congress passed the Public Health Service Act, which said, whenever the director of the Centers for Disease Control determines that the measures taken by any state are insufficient to prevent the spread of diseases, they may take measures to prevent such spread of diseases. This generally was designed to apply to things like inspection, fumigation, disinfection, sanitation, pest extermination, and destruction of animals. Did Dr. Seuss consult on this piece of legislation? But in this case, the director of the CDC decided to round that up quite a bit with his interpretation of the law, and in the process gave himself quite a bit of authority. You know what? Congress said that if I think states are doing an insufficient job at preventing disease spread, well, I can step in and implement measures that I deem fit. I deem a lot of things fit. No one said that couldn't include preventing 43 million renters from being evicted. Let's ask for forgiveness, not permission. Now because of that, the CDC extended the eviction moratorium without congressional approval. The agency interpreted what Congress wrote and applied the law accordingly. Now generous agency interpretations of congressional legislation happen very often behind the scenes, influencing everything from the EPA's ability to fight climate change to the Department of Labor's ability to enforce Biden's proposed vaccine mandates. We think a safe workspace means everyone is vaccinated, so you gotta do it. Congress told us to make the workspace safe, so yeah. In today's case, the agency interpretation in question is a lot more on the mundane side. The Department of Health and Human Services is in charge of distributing Medicare reimbursements. If you're a hospital and you buy drugs, give the HHS secretary a call and you're going to be reimbursed for the full price of the drug. That's the law. Pretty simple. But what if you're a hospital that serves low-income or other underserved populations? Well, then you get your drugs at a pretty steep discount. Should you be reimbursed for the full market price of the drugs, or should you be reimbursed for the discounted prices that you actually paid? You could make a bunch of money if you were buying at a discounted rate and receiving full priced reimbursements. That was exactly the way the system worked until 2017 when then head of Health and Human Services Alex Azar looked at the phrase full price as it appeared in the legislation said, yeah, nope, from this point onward my agency is gonna reinterpret this as the price you paid for the drugs. That's full price, and that's the reimbursement amount that we're gonna give you. The American Hospital Association was none too happy about that, so they sued claiming that the HHS didn't have the authority to make that change. Now we're here. The current practice of deferring regulatory interpretation to the federal executive branch agencies stems from the 1984 case of Chevron v. NRDC, which could be rewritten today. Instead, there are a whole bunch of other answers as to what to do, and you start bumping up against the gray area in the law. The most likely alternative that the court might pick is to defer to congressional intent. Conservatives are very much not fans of the current Chevron deference structure, so I think there's probably a pretty good chance for a large sea change with this open-ended question. Next case. In second place, we have the gun one. New York State Rifle and Pistol Association v. Bruen. Now with this one, I feel like I again need to take a little bit of a step back and explain the significance of these events. As you can probably imagine, based on every conversation we'd have so far in this episode, the actual debate here is pretty egg-headed. The main concern amongst gun control advocates is that the Supreme Court is going to go a lot further than answering this somewhat mundane question at issue today. I mean, giving the Supreme Court the opportunity to answer a narrow gun rights question is like opening Pandora's box to get a penny. Alright, you're definitely going to get your answer, but oh boy, a lot of other things might end up flowing out in the ensuing conservative opinion. So now, narrowly speaking, the case is about a New York State gun law. You want a concealed carry permit, or you're going to have to list a proper cause. Now, unfortunately for the petitioners in this case, this is a New York proper cause. None of your business, not going to be accepted. Now, they listed their proper cause as self-defense. Problem is, there wasn't anything particularly demanding about the circumstances they were living in that would warrant self-defense that's more enhanced than anyone else's. It's New York. That unsafe feeling comes with the territory. Because of that, New York deemed their rationale not to be at the level of proper cause and rejected their applications. No concealed guns for you. The narrow question is, did New York State violate the Second Amendment by refusing to grant concealed carry permits on the generalized grounds of self-defense? Now, if that was the narrow question that anybody thought the court would actually answer today, well, this case would be chilling with Ted Cruz in the back half of this list. But instead, if you want to have a little bit of legal fun and make some history, the broader question could be, what restrictions is a state allowed to put in place to regulate the licensing of weapons? Yeah, now you're starting to see how open-ended or narrow this decision could end up being. In general, the guns rights debate comes down to how much power states should have to pack in their own gun regulations beyond the ones that are passed by Congress. Conservatives are much more sympathetic towards the federal government uniformly passing gun laws without states packing their own stuff in, which the federal government conveniently never does. But progressives are a lot more gung-ho about states' ability to restrict an individual's Second Amendment rights above and beyond what the federal government will and won't allow an individual to get away with. Now, the current Second Amendment carve-outs for state regulations come from the 2008 case of District Columbia v. Heller. That case laid out the state's gun control rights in a way that feels like you're reading some sort of weird fortune cookie. Like most rights, the Second Amendment right is not unlimited. It's not a right to keep and carry any weapon whatsoever, okay, so states can limit weapon types, in any manner whatsoever, alright, hold on, states can limit the manner of what weapon is carried, and for whatever purpose. Okay, finally, states can limit the purposes you can give someone a gun for in your state. Now, today's self-defense case falls squarely under the you don't have a right to carry a weapon for whatever purpose part of that cryptic statement. So, definitely feels like New York might have a fighting chance in this case, right? Well, if this were the 2008 Supreme Court, I would 100% agree with you. Here's the rub. That was a 5-4 decision from 2008 that derived its significance from separately being the first decision to recognize that the Second Amendment granted individuals the right to bear arms, not just a well-regulated militia. The only reason all that state control carve-out stuff was even included in that decision was to lock down the swing vote of Kennedy from the conservative side. The new Supreme Court majority we're looking at today, they have a lot more limited view on how states should be able to restrict gun purchases beyond what the federal government does. For example, we have seen both Amy Coney Barrett and Kavanaugh, new addition since the last one, criticize that 2008 case, saying it should have restricted states' ability to regulate guns even more. Takeaway here is that New York State is going to 100% lose this case. The thing to look out for is how badly they get destroyed in the ensuing decision. And finally, the big kahuna of this judicial term, the abortion case. Dobbs v. Jackson Women's Health Organization. Now let's just briefly play the Uno reverse card on this last case, because now conservatives are all for states' rights to regulate this constitutionally acknowledged and protected act, while progressives are saying, whoa, states, this is my right as an American citizen. Let's keep you guys out of it. Now abortion is always a legally very strange conversation to have. Simply put, it's a tug-of-war between two entities. An entity with known legal rights, the woman, who has free will to do what she wants, hey, it's a free country, and an entity of unknown legal status, the fetus. Now this is going to be a bit of a crude analogy, but I'm trying to paint a picture here to let you know what we're talking about. Think of this debate a bit like a state banning lawn mowing, because the grass has rights. We know that the homeowner definitely 100% sure has a right to do what he wants, which includes mowing the lawn. The grass on the lawn, though, when does it get its day in court? Can the state restrict the rights of the man to protect the potential rights of the grass? Now, the rulings regarding how states can regulate abortions are a lot less set in stone than the Ten Commandments-style Roe v. Wade tablets that Democrats generally imagine when we have this conversation. The truth is, the Roe v. Wade framework has actually been entirely rewritten since its publication, as Supreme Court justices try to move back and forth to figure out just when the legal rights of a fetus kick in and when the state can cite protecting the fetus to ban all abortions. The granddaddy of all cases, Roe v. Wade, set up a trimester system. First trimester, states can't touch abortions. Second trimester, states can regulate abortions, but only to protect the health of the woman. She's got rights. And finally, the third trimester, where you can use protecting the fetus as justification to ban abortions. Third trimester, fetus got rights. Now that framework was thrown out in the 1980s by Planned Parenthood v. Casey, which created their own whole new viability framework. When a fetus is viable, it has rights. States can fully restrict post-viability abortions, citing protecting the fetus. Before the fetus is viable, though, the state can only provide abortion restrictions to protect the health of the woman. Controversially, with this rewrite, it expanded states' rights so they could now regulate first trimester abortions as long as it's for the woman's health. Now, the one thing that stayed consistent throughout these decisions is that, at some early point in pregnancy, states cannot ban abortions and can only restrict abortions if they're doing it in pursuing the interest of women's health. So now we're at today's case, where Mississippi has banned abortions that take place after a 15-week threshold, which includes some pre-viability fetuses. Now the question today is whether all pre-viability prohibitions on elective abortions are unconstitutional. Now if you were going off of case law alone, getting assigned to answer this question would easily net you a half day. Alright, banning pre-viability abortion citing protecting the fetus. Can they do that? Well, the court explicitly said in 1984 no, so no. Well, that was simple. Next case, please. Now this is represented by Mississippi's lower court's sink decision in this very case, which said, viability marks the earliest point at which the state's interest in fetal life is constitutionally adequate to justify a legislative ban on non-therapeutic abortions. Case closed? Well, not quite. If you wanted to re-litigate the tug of war between women's rights and the unknown entity of fetus's rights, Well, you could study this case and come up with all sorts of outcomes. Fetal heart beating, you become a legally viable entity. 15 weeks? Conception? We'll see. The dates are all a bit more arbitrary than people like to admit. So those are the 9 most significant Supreme Court cases going on in this term. Let me know if I missed any of the cases that you're excited about seeing. And until next time, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Oy, my voice is a bit hoarse after that long episode. Hello YouTube, I'd like to thank my patrons over here for helping me put out my videos. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the overlooked, join this growing list of exceptional individuals by clicking on the link in the description. Also remember to like and subscribe and ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring. And lastly, as always, thank you for watching.